We've reached 7:05, so I think we can get started. Welcome everyone to this final event in this year's Sound Studies Institute online lecture series. For those of you who don't know me, I am Laurel Parsons and I teach music theory and oral skills at the University of Alberta. Unfortunately, Scott Smallwood is unable to be with us tonight as he's in Belfast at a festival where it is currently 2 a.m. So he will be participating, but asynchronously, by watching the recording at a later time. And he's asked me to introduce tonight's distinguished guest speaker, Dr. Horace Maxile, Jr. Dr. Maxile is Associate Professor of Music Theory. He holds a Ph.D. in Musicology from Louisiana State University. He teaches at Baylor University and prior to that, taught at the University of North Carolina at Asheville. He has served as Associate Director of Research at the Center for Black Music Research in Chicago. His research interests include the concert music of African-American composers, gospel music, and musical semiotics. Among his publications are articles and perspectives of new music, annual review of jazz studies, Black Music Research Journal, Journal for the Society of American Music, and American Music. He was associate editor of the Encyclopedia of African-American Music and has served as editor of the Black Music Research Journal, the chair of the Society for Music Theory Committee on Diversity, and has also served on the American Musicological Society Council. Horace is one of the, I think it's fair to say there is, I don't think there's anyone who knows more about the music of classical Black composers than Horace. So it's a great privilege for us to have him here tonight. On a personal note, I've had the pleasure of getting to know Horace over the past several years, too many, more than I want to count, for the length of time it has taken the book to come out, that he has kindly contributed a chapter for, excuse me, in my own book series, Analytical Essays on Music by Women Composers. And he has contributed a wonderful chapter on the piano sonata of Florence Price to that volume, which is coming out shortly. And for the past 2 years in my Music 455 class, my students have been inspired by his visits to talk to with them about the music of Olly Wilson. So I'm thrilled to be able to introduce him to a wider audience here tonight, here in the Texas of the North. And I'm very much looking forward to hearing his talk, which is entitled Musical Signifyin, Examining Aesthetics of Homage and Play in Selected Black works by Black composers. So please join me in giving a hearty Alberta welcome to Dr. Maxile.
All right, thank you, Laurel, for that introduction. And in the interest of time, I'm just gonna jump in and hopefully I can get to everything. But if not, I'll cut a few things short to make sure that we have ample time for Q&A and discussion. Is that fine with everyone's view?
Perfect.
As the field of Black music studies has expanded from the late 1960s to the present, a number of scholars helped identify elements and sound phenomena which are associated with African-American musical traditions. Samuel Floyd, in the introduction to The Power of Black Music, lists, quote, "The elements we have come to know as the foundational elements of African-American music. Calls, cries, hollers, call and response devices, additive rhythms and polyrhythms, heterophony, pendular thirds, blue notes, bent notes, and elisions, interjections and punctuations, offbeat melodic phrasing, the constant repetition of rhythmic and melodic figures from which riffs and vamps would be derived, musical individuality within collectivity, a part playing, and the metronomic pulse that underlies all African-American music," end quote. Olly Wilson, an African-American composer, goes a step further by proposing an approach to define Black music traditions. To quote Wilson, quote, "The substance of that approach is that the essence of Black musical tradition consists of shared conceptual approaches to music making. and hence is not basically quantitative, but qualitative. He continues to explain that particular forms of Black music are realizations of a conceptual framework that reflects the Black experience, and the manifestations of this framework are infinite. He states that the common core of this framework, quote, consists of the way of doing something, not simply that something is done, end quote. Time will not permit a thorough unpacking of Wilson's conceptual how, but my approaches to interpreting music by African-American composers are informed by examining elements listed by Floyd through the lens of Wilson's how and their relationships to the structural properties of compositions. Also central to my framework is Floyd's concept of musical signifying. The concept of signifying is developed in Hearing Lewis Gates' theory of African-American literary criticism in the book The Signifying Monkey. Gates interprets African-American literature and vernacular culture through the signifying concept. For his part, Floyd asserts that African-American music, quote, can be examined through the same vernacular tradition, end quote, and that unique emblems and sound phenomena of African-American musical traditions can serve as signifying figures. He defines musical signifying as, quote, troping, the transformation of pre-existing material by trifling with it, teasing it, or censoring it, end quote. Let's listen to a little bit of signifying.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
Explanations, Floyd continues, for in signifying, the emphasis is on the signifier, not the signified. In African-American music, musical figures signify by commenting on other musical figures, on themselves, on performances of other music, on performances of the same piece, and on completely new works of music, end quote. The signifying process then is both dynamic, musical figures commenting on other musical figures, and intertextual, musical figures commenting on themselves. By considering historical, cultural, and interpretive perspectives as they relate to works by African-American composers, I seek to explore interpretive stances into sounds and sources that shape the expressive trajectories of selected works while using Floyd's concept of signifying as a framing agent. With these thoughts in mind, let's look at Harry Burleigh's A Jubilee. Not quite ready for the clip. In addition to connotations that evoke anniversaries or biblical subjects, a jubilee is also known as a Black folk song that is thematically connected to future happiness or deliverance from tribulation. Pentatonicism and syncopated dancing rhythms characterize much of the melodic content of Burleigh's Jubilee, lending its folksy air. In addition, occasional uses of stride-like accompaniment patterns enhance the light, celebratory feel of certain passages. Each of the pieces in the suite is prefaced by an epigraph by the composer's wife, Louise Alston Burleigh. The one for A Jubilee reads, "Although you see me go long so, my spirit's bound for the heavenly show. Walk right up to the golden dough, to my home in the New Jerusalem." There are no major shifts in key, as F major is the tonal center for the entire piece. There are a few chromatic chords that offer moments of color, but the essence of Jubilee is affirmed in the upbeat, folk-inspired tunes that recall vernacular musical emblems. Indeed, the optimism of the major key and the essence of dance suggests a happiness that is either present and/or anticipates the joy that is to come in the New Jerusalem. Let's listen to a little bit.
Thank you.
feelings of lightheartedness or joy in the promise of heaven in a jubilee are not large interpretive leaps that require much substantiation. But the opening lines of the epigraph broaden the frame for interpretations involving the stance of the poetic subject. Although you see me go long so, my spirit's bound for the heavenly show. Possible readings might invoke a suggestive response by Burleigh to conditions of Black people faced in the Jim Crow South, or perhaps a nod of homage to a notable contemporary and friend, Anton Dvorak, who died a few years before this suite was composed. These rather diverse readings stem from, or better yet, converge on a distorted quotation of a Stephen Foster minstrel song, Old Folks at Home, also known as Swanee River. I'll share some of the lyrics. All up and down the whole creation, sadly I roam, still longing for the old plantation and for the old folks at home. All the world am sad and dreary everywhere I roam. Oh, darkies, how my heart grows weary, far from the old folks at home. Let's listen to a little more of the Burleigh, and we'll stop around where that quotation of the Foster tune comes in. Back it up just a tad. Foster's lyrics present a longing on the part of the slave to return to his old plantation and a sense of nostalgia. But Burleigh's particular statement and its relatively complex harmonic setting question that perspective and position it as ancillary to the glories of heavenly, of a heavenly home, or freedom and equality while on earth. Richly ironic in the global and intramusical context that suggests jubilant expectations of better days, the musical quotation provocatively situates the poetic subject in the South at the turn of the century, where social and economic progress may have been well distant, or as distant as heaven. Thus, the subject suggests that what is seen by a society, a gracious, moderated persistence or going along amid unrest, is temporal. But what is not seen, the spirit, is resolved, settled, and rejoices in what is to come. Burleigh's vivid play with this minstrel tune on the corresponding word river, right, way down upon the Swanee River, instead of the large octave leap, and the passage's ultimate goal of preparing the home key of Jubilee could therefore be interpreted as an understated motif of resistance or liberation. Indeed, the course of Burleigh's river differs from that of a yearning, misdirected slave and leads to a better life, or at least a Jubilee. Let's look at an excerpt of John Work's At a Certain Church from a three-movement piano suite entitled Scuppernong, Three Pieces for Country Folks. While there are some interesting harmonic treatments and pitch relationships that I would love to unpack, my focus this evening is on a very subtle African-American emblem as experienced with this statement of the home, statement of this hymn tune, I am bound for the promised land. The treatment of harmony and melody is significant when the tune is first stated in the work piece. He chooses a harmonization that is typical of what would have been heard in African-American congregations. Regional specificities notwithstanding, the parallel movement of voices against the melody would have been, and still is, typical of African-American improvised and composed harmonizations in some sacred forms, namely gospel music. Melodies in Black sacred traditions are harmonized in this way, with the soprano, alto, and tenor voices moving in parallel motion. And I'm including this example because this is an example from a hymnal that would have been in print around the time that this piece is composed. And I only show this to show the static, motion of the tenor voice. The tenor is just sitting on this one note while all of the other notes are moving around it. And so this is what would have been in a hymnal during that time, and this particular arrangement has survived in a number of other hymnals, even into the 21st century. These differences between this hymn and the work do not necessarily prove that work was definitely evoking the Black church, but his treatment of the tune is highly suggestive. Let's look at his harmonization and listen to the moments leading up to it. In listening to the parallel movement in the voices, did you notice an inner voice that sounded a little improvised? If we continue with an interpretation based on performance practice and aesthetic preferences encountered in African-American musical culture, we might interpret this as an individual asserting himself or herself with an added note or two within the collective ensemble moment. Such interpolations are common in certain worship experiences and hardly, if ever, interrupt the flow of worship. The interactive aspect of certain worship experiences, in effect, produces many textures involving leaders, individual utterances, and group exhortations. While the hierarchy of this experience is structured, everyone does have the opportunity to participate in worship. This active yet orderly communion of participants creates an expressive dynamic unique to certain African American worship experiences. In the absence of blue notes and jazz harmonies that often signify vernacular presence, work's treatment of texture here offers yet another topic to consider when we think about signification in African American musical culture. Olly Wilson dedicated Sometimes for Tenor and Tape to his parents who, through love and patience, taught him how to sing. Wilson comments on the piece, quote, "I attempted to recreate within my own musical language not only the profound expression of hopelessness and desolation that characterizes the traditional spiritual, but also simultaneously on another level, a reaction to that desolation that transcends hopelessness." Issues surrounding cultural memory and homage immediately surface when we consider Wilson's own words, the dedicatees, and the intentions of what he wished to capture or portray. Wilson grew up in a musical household where he playfully recounts his father saying that children must play the piano in order to eat. As his father was a church singer, he used this motivation to train accompanists who ultimately played for church choirs and Sunday teas. Hymns, anthems, spirituals, and gospel were a part of Wilson's musical life during those formative years, and he considered his early childhood experiences in church, quote, "an important part of my musical background," end quote. Wilson's reinterpretation or revision of the original spiritual tune in Sometimes, or Sometimes I Feel Like a Motherless Child, and a number of subsequent works embrace contemporary techniques while also conserving the character of the source material. The text and tune of the spiritual are essentially deconstructed by Wilson's use of fragments and extended sections that highlight pre-recorded words spoken or sung by tenor William Brown, such as Sometimes and Mother. The electronic media available to him at the time assisted the manipulations of sound that created sonic phenomena that were unique, innovative, and practically boundless. Such modernist approaches typify and in some ways amplify the essence of Floyd's signifying concept. Whereas an undoubtable ethereal quality emanates from Wilson's treatment and setting of the text, Brown's virtuosity and sensitivity to the spirit of the source material establishes a transcendent air through which the vernacular emblems speak. Wilson's setting of the tenor's text recalls African-American singing traditions ranging from melismatic renderings to subtle timbral distortions that highlight Brown's brilliant and bronzed upper register. Wilson's performance instructions and directions for staging also provide solid points for interpretive stances. This example shows the stage positioning diagram that is provided in the score. The piece begins with the singer in position one, stage right. The tenor is to begin singing in position one and should be in position two when he reaches a high D flat at the 4:30 mark on the recording. Extended vocal techniques such as tongue trills, hisses, and splutts are featured in the tenor's initial statements and dramatic rise to the apex. Let's listen. Piece. I wish we could listen more. Melodic fragments meander around the low vocal register and gradually increase in pitch level and intensity for 2 minutes until the apex. Following the apex, extended vocal techniques cease momentarily. Wilson's release from this high D flat that we just heard at the end features a slightly more florid vocal line as the tenor is asked to sing in his normal voice after the arrival to center stage. It appears as though the extended vocal techniques merge more so with the electronic soundscape at the beginning of the piece, allowing for the more discernible text and tonation to become the focal point after the singer reaches center stage. The moment at center stage features the tenor in a duet with a recorded voice. The result, for Floyd, yielded a mythic quality where Brown is, quote, a caller and also a crier, both live and on tape, end quote. Let's listen to that moment. Bearing in mind the time spent in the studio preparing the tape, the mix, and the score, it seems reasonable to expand the concept of musical signifying to experience Brown, at least in this recording, as the one troping and the one doing the troping upon that thing that is being troped. Thus, the signifying process in general, and as exemplified in this expressive duet, again, is both dynamic, Brown commenting on sometimes, and intertextual, Brown commenting on himself. The final move to stage left, position three, is even more intriguing. According to Wilson's performance notes, at the point of the climaxic fortissimo clang, the tenor should move rapidly to the rear left side of the stage. He notes that the remainder of the piece should be performed in this position. Immediately after the clang, the tenor hums melodic fragments and whistles, an extended technique withheld until this emotionally charged episode. Let's listen to a little bit of that moment. Some interpretive questions arise. Why, after a dramatic rise in pitch and full statements of discernible text, does the subject move immediately from the center stage and begin to whistle or hum? Is the clang symbolic of external or oppressive forces? Was center stage home for the subject at least momentarily? Home could very well be center stage for the personified subject, as that is the space where most of the notable troping revisions take place. There is a gradual increase in musical tension leading up to that fortissimo clang as Wilson layers complex rhythmic activity in the voice with a myriad of effects in electronic voices. The arrival of the clang is sudden, perhaps signaling an interruption of a course of striving to ascend or get past this downtrodden essence of the text. The immediacy of the clang could also be interpreted as Wilson pointing listeners to extra musical distractions, struggles, or clangs that accompany or perhaps attempt to muffle the refrains of transcendence in journeys toward freedom and solidarity. Indeed, the tenor continues with inaudible moans and whistles that signal persistence, even when words are imperceptible, and home, on the stage, and in terms of pitch center, is not as certain. I first came across the music of Dr. Frederick Tillis when I worked on a project involving music composed during the Civil Rights Movement. He wrote a very powerful choral piece in 1968 entitled Freedom, which reflects his personal feelings after learning of the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King. Aside from his international reputation as a concert music composer, he is also a well-respected jazz saxophonist. Tillis has incorporated African-American elements in his compositions since 1968. And this raises an intriguing parallel to the piece Freedom that was composed in the wake of King's death, also in 1968. During that year, Tillis asked himself probing questions about his compositional palette, which at that time hardly included any cultural references. Since that time, his music has included elements of African, Asian, and European cultures. In 1980, Tillis began a set of works called Spiritual Fantasies. To date, there are about 31. Complete pieces composed for a variety of instrumental and vocal combinations. All of them use the African-American spiritual in some form or another. Some references are literal, others are more abstract. He said that he started the series because he wanted to keep the spiritual tradition alive. Tillis completed Spiritual Fantasy No. 12 for string quartet in 1988. It is believed that the premiere recording by the Lark String Quartet in 1996 was produced by produced from a revised version of the score completed in 1995. We make note of this because the liner notes from the recording give 1995 as the date of completion, but earlier scores held by the composer and the International Dictionary of Black Composers both cite 1988 as the copyright date. Each of the four movements uses material from four different spirituals and are entitled Nobody Knows the Trouble I See, Wade in the Water, Crucifixion, and I'm a Rollin'. Each movement is named for the source of its thematic and motivic material. Tillis said that this work pays tribute to the essence of the musical expression and pathos and triumph over worldly obstacles encountered by a people who found hope and strength through their faith in God. My interest in the third movement, Wade in the Water, were initially piqued by the interesting rhythms and how the composer superimposed the melody from the spiritual into that context. In addition, my knowledge of the jazz background offered even more insight into his harmonizations and unison passages that sounded like kind of sax solo moments. The liberal and thoughtful blending of these vernacular emblems throughout the piece is noteworthy, but the way in which these actually function is interesting. Let's listen. Here's the string quartet. Tillis recorded Motherless Child in a single take in 1989 on solo saxophone. Presented as a statement of the tune, a series of choruses, and a return to the tune, Tillis's ideas range from bebop lines that adhere to implied harmonies to more abstract complexes. One of the choruses, however, is particularly relevant to our discussions here about source and inspiration. Let's listen to Tillis's solo saxophone rendition of Motherless Child. Indeed, Tillis borrows from or signifies on his own revision of Wade in the Water as a source of inspiration for a chorus on Motherless Child. It is worth noting that the mixed meter gesture or the really interesting rhythmic figures on which I focused in the string quartet clip appear in the final movement of the string quartet as well. Whereas it serves as a unifying figure in the context of a multi-movement work, in one context it also serves as a point of departure for an improvised chorus in another. The New Black Music Repertory Ensemble recorded five movements in color in 2009 as part of the first volume of recorded music of the African Diaspora series. I had the pleasure of meeting the composer Mary Watkins during the recording sessions. Realizing the importance of the moment, I asked for an impromptu interview during lunch. I happened to have a recording device handy during the time. Our discussion was centered on inspiration and elements in the composition that were distinctively Black. I told her upon my first hearing of the piece, I identified vernacular emblems in three of the five movements, and I continued to explain what I heard. She nodded affirmatively as if I hit the nail on the head. I then continued and asked about the second and fifth movements, where emblems were not as apparent. Regarding the second movement, Soul of Remembrance, and while gathering her thoughts, she said that the melody was pentatonic and was reminiscent of what she had heard in church. Immediately following her statement about the church, she said, "That song, Remember Me." Then she started to sing the song softly, and it sounded like this. Followed with discussing the movement in the context of the entire piece by saying, quote, "Well, it starts out that way. I don't think I, at the time, thought about it. I must have, because I had the first part and it was already slightly different than what I started thinking about the second movement. And then I started making adjustments in the xylophone in the first movement and at the very beginning. So I think the feeling is, I guess you can say African-American. I've always mixed the elements, European and African, the essence of the two. And for me, that worked perfectly for the soul of humanity, really. But I saw my own people in their long march to fully express themselves as fully human, you know, in a society where we were always boxed in by this or that. You know, it's like I am. So it's the divine elements in a soul. And I was particularly thinking about my people, but I also think of everyone." This sentiment resonates throughout the movement. Although slow and pensive, this movement is neither dirge-like or melancholy. It is indeed hopeful and optimistic. Watkins' lyrical song opens with a sober melody along with a faintly pulsating harp and pizzicato bass accompaniment. The faint pulse persists in the chordal accompaniment and reinforces dramatic shape, but the composer's subtle play with rhythm and harmony delays and averts expected cadences, lending a compelling sense of unrest and uncertainty. The song Remember Me is, for Watkins, a point of reference for an original theme. Watkins' memory of what she heard in church as a child served as a reference point for addressing the soul of humanity. Ambiguity and certain treatments of harmony may imply uncertainty and unrest, but there is hope in the significant structural arrival of D major, as we kind of heard that coming in and out in that particular excerpt. The constant pulse carried by the harp is a strong reference to the march, but subtle counterpoints and dissonances between meter and chord changes suggest that there may be more obstacles for African Americans in the years to come. How are we on time? I wanted to have a little fun. Can we have a little fun now? Sure, okay, let's have a little fun.
Let's have a little fun.
Let's have a little fun. All right, so this last section of my talk is kind of a little more informal, and we can really open up our ears. But I'd like to do kind of a little bit of a show and tell type of presentation that shows us the various ways in which Western emblems, or classicisms, if you will, interact with African-American musical forms and styles. You know, a little bit more of the signifying piece. We'll start with Ralph Simpson's Jacob's Ladder, a paraphrase. And I don't know whether I should sit quietly and enjoy the counterpoint or if I should just shout hallelujah. It's really a conflicting thing. But every round goes higher and higher. But the really interesting thing about this piece is that this piece was composed by Simpson for a student who found counterpoint boring. Whoa. Too many things started happening at one time. Let's go back. And I should also note that the original version of this piece was composed for organ. Okay. Now let's listen to a little bit of Richard Smallwood's, let's go to V. Michael McKay's Behind the Curtain. V. Michael McKay and soprano Henrietta Davis offer yet another stance in the song Behind the Curtain. While certain orchestrations and harmonic emblems and vocal techniques definitely show a Western influence, Davis's vocal performance is noteworthy here. In the third verse, the highlight of the piece, in my opinion. The soloist actually shifts from timbres of a Western derivation to a full, bona fide, full-throated gospel rendition. The third verse goes like this: a gathering at the river, a shadow of immortality, a sinner healed, a proud seraphim, a moment waiting for me. beautiful, beautiful song. We'll just kind of leave that there. I got to get through one more. Richard Smallwood's Jesus Lover of My Soul. I'm just going to let this clip speak for itself. Beside the quick survey of pieces in a relatively short period of time, I hope to have demonstrated two things. One, the broad and complex range of expressive uses of Black vernacular emblems and works by African-American composers, and two, the richness of interpretations that engage intersections of those emblems with the structures and expressive trajectories of the compositions in which they appear. To be sure, this paper is a snapshot of a larger project devoted to the questions and issues raised at the beginning of the paper. That larger project is a continuous of studies and on signification and meaning in concert works by African American composers, driven by not so much by what, but more so by how these works mean. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Horace, for this fascinating talk. Once again, you have opened my mind and my ears to a whole world of music that I am so grateful to have been introduced to. This is time for people to ask questions. Are there people who have thoughts or comments or questions they'd like to share? Tom says everybody's able to unmute themselves now.
Mariam has a hand up. I think you can.
Oh, sorry. Yes,
Mariam. Go, Mariam. Yeah.
Oh, shall I just, Horace? I'm wading in, and I haven't formulated a question because I have like a whole, team of conflicting questions. But I guess the piece that affected me the most was Behind the Curtain. And that sort of just breaking, that explosion of everything. It's like, get out of the way. Get out of the way, right? And I think that is something that just can't fail to move. And it's something that, you don't have to know. You don't have to know the semiotics or it's a cry that you understand just as a human being by dint of being human. I'm willing to wager that, even though I'm willing to wager that. And I want to say, it's a little bit of an ignorant question, but I want to say this, that in the others, in the other examples, I was almost like waiting for that, you know, and I didn't realize it until I heard this, that this is kind of, this is the semiotics I was waiting for, because this is the association that I make. And so, and what's wrong with that? Or is there something wrong with that? Or how do you respond to that? Because I'm confused. So help me out.
Thank you for that question. It's a wonderful question. And I guess I should say we should qualify this by saying that, you know, I decided to flip the script, you know, with Behind the Curtain and Jesus Lover of My Soul, because those are essentially marketed and labeled and perhaps understood as gospel pieces that are using these Western emblems, you know. So even there, the cry that you heard in the third verse that I played for you doesn't happen until the third verse. And so Miss Henrietta Davis performs the entire piece with this very rounded, you know, vibrato throughout. And so the piece actually has lots of elements of recitative in it. And it was kind of composed as this opening moment to a larger spiritual opera that was never finished by this composer. So we have those elements that are warring, and then basically she basically just gives up and lets the folks know, I can really sing this song the way it needs to be sung. And she switches from the tone, or better yet, could we say switching codes, switching from the Western code to the vernacular code, and then goes into these cries and so on that you are associating with the meaning and the feelings of signification. But when we think about the perspective of Black composers trying to convey something similar to that in a more Western idiom, how do you get a violin to cry? How do you, and in what context is the violin crying? How do you get a piano to do it? So even when we think about the John work at a certain church, you know, let's think programmatically. We heard the bells, right? Dung, 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 dung. So if we really want to think about what that might have been for the Black folk church, you know, the folk church was probably how a lot of folks told time, by the ringing and the tolling of the bells. So that was basically a call to church. And so then after that, you have these parallel movements. And so that's a very subtle thing that you could probably hear there. But even before, and then after that, when you get into the Sometimes I Feel Like a Motherless Child by Olly Wilson, you have an electronic soundscape. So then you have to ask yourself, what is amplified and what gets lost? Okay. And so actually, Olly Wilson was critiqued, and he was criticized by a number of his contemporaries because he used those types of techniques and those types of mediums. He was basically saying, how dare you use basically the white man's instrument or the white man's this to try to convey your Blackness? And his reply was, first and foremost, that I don't hear you talking to Adolph Sachs when you hear John Coltrane, and I don't hear you talking to Hammond when you hear Jimmy Smith on the Hammond organ. So both of those instruments were, you know, created by non-Black people, but they were used by Black people to forge these expressive voices. And so he went on further to say, and in conjunction with an African proverb, that the instrument becomes an extension of the person that is holding it. So that's an African proverb. So when I touch electronic media, then electronic media becomes Black because I'm the one controlling it. So then the question is, what is lost in translation? Yes, there's definitely some things that get lost because we have expectations built into what we expect these things to be. But at the same time, what actually gets amplified in Sometimes I Feel Like a Motherless Child? That is one of the most powerful renditions of that spiritual that I know of, and because it is unique and it captures so many things that a solo voice or a chorus or a gospel choir cannot.
Well, you know, I mean, thank you. That's a beautiful answer. Thank you. Sometimes I Feel Like a Motherless Child, I mean, I loved like your hermeneutic reading of it. Mm-hmm. Because you have to get on stage, like not physically, but you have to figure out the meaning of those positions and figure out those non-human sounds. Mm-hmm. Along with the human sound, and then put that together. I mean, the labor of interpretation to really understand that piece is massive.
Yes.
It doesn't come and punch you in the face, but you have to approach it. And so, yeah, thank you.
And there are some things even that I couldn't get into, but it's often said in the Black church, if you will, that when you moan, that means the devil doesn't know what you're talking about. So basically, when you do all of this, sometimes I feel like a motherless child, full-throated and center stage, and then at a certain point you start to retreat to a place perhaps where the devil can't see you, and you start to moan and hum and whistle. You're still making your vocal sentiments known. You're still imploring to whomever or whatever about your condition. But in that case, in the absence of text, perhaps the devil don't know what you're talking about. And so that's just another way to read that. So we basically have electronic media and these kind of mergings and mixings, and then we have a full-throated, sometimes I feel like a motherless child, and these high, high bronze tenor notes, and then immediately we hear something that sounds like an oppressive force, this boom, you know, and then the singer is supposed to run and actually stand behind the speaker that is on stage. And so then you still hear, because the singer still has the microphone, the hums and the whistles, and so there's still music there, and there's still some conflict going on. So there's a lot going on in that piece, along with the speakers that are supposed to be surrounding, I think they're supposed to be eight, surrounding the auditorium. So it's a pretty complex piece.
Horace, have you been there for a performance? Have you?
I have not. I've only heard wonderful anecdotal tales about how to produce the work, because the person running the tape has to be able to read, because there are moments when the tape is supposed to be shut off where it's just solo voice, and so the person that is operating the tape has to know how to read so that when the soloist gets to a particular point, the tape comes back on. So there are things so that the instrumentalist or the accompanist, the tape person, has to be able to read the score. And I think it's recently been staged in Washington State at the University of Puget Sound, I think, maybe within the past year. I think that's the most recent performance of the piece. I'm not sure if that's been recorded or not. There are two recordings that I know of this piece. One is the one we heard, and then there's another one by, some Hispanic tenor. And his name is escaping me right now, but those are the only two recordings that I'm aware of.
I think there is a YouTube recording. Is there not? Am I right about that?
Yeah, I think the YouTube might be brown. The YouTube might be brown.
It wouldn't capture everything.
Yeah. Yeah. So just listening to it is one thing. But this was around the time when Olly Wilson was experimenting with sound installation. So, you know, we're talking about this whole multimedia thing. And so he was really, really into electroacoustic music and the tape music and so on. And so this is right in the middle of that phase of his work. But this is one of the few that actually kind of bring in these elements of Black culture, if you will, explicitly, so to speak. And I should also say that he was moved to write this piece because he heard William Brown at a conference. And he said that once William Brown finished his rendition of a spiritual, there was not a dry eye in the entire auditorium. He said, so at that point, he knew that he had to write something for this amazing tenor. And he invited him out to the studio. And so all of the voices that you hear on the recorded tape are actually William Brown. So Brown is singing with himself. So it's a really, really interesting, dare I say, unique recording.
Well, Mario mentioned that sort of bursting out. It's a tour de force for the singer behind the curtain to have to make those shifts. It's
just I think that shift was that might have been her shift. I don't know, but to wait. Well, it's really interesting because I think she knew that it was going to come. Because there was a moment where she slipped into a gospel tone and then went right back into the you know, I think she said gathering at the river. And when she went into the river, she slipped, you know, into a deeper chest voice. And then she pulled it back up a little bit. And then at the moment, you know, where she put all the melismas at the end was that. But basically up to that point, it was full rolling vibrato and so many other things on a very interesting text. But even when we think about or when we consider the harmony in that piece, that's not quite what I would think of as gospel harmony. That's not what I'm playing in church every Sunday morning. So that's, you know, when I'm sitting on the organ at church, I'm not doing behind the curtain harmonies. And I'm not trying to get all strings and stringy and all that other stuff and little, you know, bells and all that. No, I'm just trying to make some things happen. So so just from the standpoint of what we perceive gospel to be, you know, it can incorporate a lot of things. It can be a very dynamic music, you know, something that welcomes and exposes and expounds on a lot of different things, yet still be gospel, I guess, at the same time.
Yeah, and there was that moment at the end in the position three of the sometimes where it's so high and beautiful that there is that cry that seems to be breaking out, but of course not with the power, you know, behind the curtain bursting out. It's a different kind of...
Right. So, it's a really interesting recording, because even I think, I don't know if it's on this actual recording, but if you look at the YouTube recording, after the song is done, she goes into this basically improvised verse of, "Oh, I want to see him look upon his face, there to sing forever on his saving," you know. So she's basically going out of that piece into a hymn with all of the, if you will, the trappings and the melismas and everything that really make her a notable gospel artist or a force. But the ability to go in and out of those various tones in one recording and in one sitting is a truly amazing vocal feat. It's one of the clips or one of the pieces that I enjoy the most from this particular composer, and it really exemplifies a lot of different things.
This would be a wonderful concert to be able to hear all of these pieces from beginning to end. Are there other questions that people have?
I have a comment.
Yeah, go ahead, Mariam.
I have to find out, but this is a medieval saying, I believe, or even like early medieval, according to which, and I don't know who it's by, and I really don't know anything, but that music that can be notated is failed music. It's a failure of music to be able to notate it. And this, you know, I mean, there are a lot of moments that make me think about that. Because what makes music, like the spirituality of music, is precisely the fact that it cannot be captured. So that residuum that can be captured in the form of notation, well, you know, it's not the real thing. It's a saying like that, but I have to figure out where it's from. But when you put these two extremes together in tension with one another, I think maybe we're skirting, you know, back and forth against this like invisible fault line, as well, isn't it? Yeah.
I agree with you 100%. But the idea of the composer, and the challenge of trying to the challenge and the charge, I guess, for some composers to try to recreate their experiences and to try to convey that to audiences and to get other people to... Can you imagine the difficulty of even trying to notate a score for sometimes, for tenor and tape? The score is a wonderful thing to look at and to even follow along, knowing that every time you hear it, it might be a little bit different because you're looking at time points. You aren't looking at meter. You know, you're looking at gestures, you're looking at cues, you know, and so there's so many different things there. But I think I agree with you, but I also want to think about the score, loosely construed, as a point of departure, you know? So even if I were to look at a hymn, you know, in a hymnal, I'm getting key, perhaps, or at least I'm getting at least the contour of what the melody is supposed to be. And so maybe some of those things that aren't necessarily able to be captured with regard to some of the spiritual essence that I think you're headed toward, and I agree with that. But what about the framing agent of having somewhere to, you know, to apply yourself? You know, where can you, or from what platform or from what foundation can you? I'm thinking about the jazz improviser right now. You know, how can the jazz improviser do jazz without a tune? You know, and then we have the you know, the free jazz of, you know, Ornette Coleman and things like that, and that starts to get away to the abstract. But then when you think about 32 bar song forms and things like that, and what Charlie Parker and Coltrane and Davis were all able to do within that frame, that gives each of them their own individual sense of individuality, but they're still a platform from which. So maybe I'm thinking about the score as a framing agent or a point of departure, as opposed to the be all and end all. You know, so yeah, so that's, I guess.
Okay, I just want to add though, because you, this is signifying, right? This, mm-hmm. this presentation is about signifying, and there is that unbelievable vernacular. Mm-hmm. That is there. It's just like it's ready to hand. It's there. It's this vernacular. It's like the saxophone piece, the Tillis, yeah, piece. It's ready to hand. It's right there. So yeah. I mean, it's a very, very interesting place that you're occupying, I think, in your research. Yeah.
They're wonderful and disturbing counterpoints all the way through. They're wonderful dissonances. And I often wonder, you know, as I write my own analyses and write my own interpretations, am I giving true credence to both traditions? You know, am I being, you know, true to what the composer is wanting to convey? You know, because when we think about the Tillis, you know, how do you get a string quartet to do what you just did as a solo saxophonist? Yeah, you're going to have to mix some 3-4 with some 5-4 and then maybe put a 7-8 in there to make it happen exactly the way that it happened for him. And so that's why you have those kind of mixed meters in his score. So he's basically trying to capture his improvisation and even share that part of himself with an aesthetic, perhaps, and perhaps with a value system that is beyond that of the jazz aficionado. So how do I bring myself? How do I bring this culture? How do I bring this essence of who I am to a larger audience, be it classical or otherwise? And so those are the things that really interest me about what composers, or in particular African-American composers, you know, wrestle with. You know, how do I convey this? How do I do that? And how do I write it clear enough to where it's done correctly, to where people don't just assume, because I am a Black composer, that every note is supposed to swing? That's the other side of it. Let's deal with the composer's notation as it is. Hale, mm-hmm, Smith was one composer that was really, really strict about that. He says, if I wanted to swing, I know how to write swing eighth notes, or I'll tell you to do that. But just don't assume that because I am a Black composer that I want everything to swing. So that's the other side. You know, that's the other side of this dichotomy. So even though there's the spirituality and the essence of the folk and all these other things, we have to honor the score. And I'm thinking particularly about William Grant Steele's Afro-American Symphony. The solo trumpet in the exposition, if you will, is not notated with dotted values. However, in the recapitulation, the trumpet stuff is notated with dotted 16ths followed by eighths, which was his way of saying that I want it to swing now. But perhaps he does not want it to swing in the exposition. So then when you get into the rhetorical structure of what sonata form can be, then if the tonic key and the essence of who I am wins in the end, then you don't need to swing the eighth notes at the beginning. You need them to be straight, so that we can also get a return to tonic and we can get the swing rhythms in the recapitulation when everything falls out of the curtain. So those are just some very specific things about notation and what composers are really up against and when they are trying to convey and how they are trying to convey these particular emblems and aesthetic choices.
I'm kind of curious about Burleigh. That song at the beginning, A Jubilee, I expected some of the textures of that song and the styles I expected, but I didn't expect the changing styles, and I especially didn't expect that kind of twisted quotation of Swanee River. This is 1910. It seems kind of early to be create that kind of distortion, irony. Mamby Mariam will argue with me about that. I don't know. But you know, you have quotations, but you don't have quotations that are sardonic. To me, that sounded sardonic.
Yeah, there are a couple of ways to take that. I mean, and we can you can go as deep as you want to with Burleigh as a performer. He was a church musician. He was one of the leading baritones in the Northeast. But you know, I think his church tried to do some kind of little minstrel thing, you know, just to try to raise. Yeah, so there are connections to minstrelsy, loosely. And of course, Burleigh wasn't a big fan of minstrelsy. So when you think about, oh, and I should also add that Burleigh was asked by Dvorak to be the baritone for his arrangement of Old Folks at Home for a benefit concert in New York while Dvorak was in New York. So Burleigh had to sing this song. And one wonders if he actually sang it in dialect or if some of the words changed. You know, so you have Burleigh in this tune. There's a lot of things going on with Burleigh in this particular tune. And so now you have this idea of jubilee, and then you have the poetic epigraph saying that even though you see me going along with everything that you see me going along with, my spirit is going somewhere else. And so then when all of that comes together on this distorted quotation of the tune, I kind of read it as him just taking a stab at everything and everybody, just saying, hey, you know, I'll do this tune, but I'm going to change it and distort it and really give you some sarcasm here. And it's not the only time. It also happens at the end of the piece as well.
Well, and that's the other part of that is I was going to ask you about that relationship between Burleigh and Dvorak.
Yeah. They were friends. They were friends. A lot of people say that Burleigh was his student. That's not necessarily the case. That's not quite the way that happened. Burleigh did sing spirituals for Dvorak often, and those renditions that Burleigh sang for him were the inspiration for his New World Symphony. I do believe that he was his copyist in a number of occasions. So he was, you know, he got some good harmonic language stuff by looking at Dvorak's scores. But you know, they were friends, and Dvorak died in, I think, 1904. And I think the sketches maybe on this piece start as early as 1907. So this could have been a nod to a departed friend, you know, remembering you. Oh, do you remember when you actually asked me to sing this minstrel tune? Really, man? You know, that kind of, so it could have been that kind of playful nod of homage. But it could also be a serious commentary on the plight of, you know, the title of the entire suite is From the Southland. So he could have been thinking about Black people in the Jim Crow South, and he did not like the South, and he very seldom went down there. So a lot of things kind of converge on that one quotation.
Gosh, so many avenues of thought here opening up. Is there anyone else? Gail or Tom?
I was muted. Okay. I have a quick sort of question, or I wondered something during the presentation. Maybe I'm off base, but the Olly Wilson Sometimes for Tenor and Tape, you mentioned at one point, because it says he's singing with himself on the tape, he becomes both a caller and a crier at the same time, kind of. Uh-huh. And this kind of made me think about, I wonder if there's something in there that's kind of, I wonder if there's a possibility to comment or reflect on singing with the tape as kind of a reflection of a practice of learning about traditional music by singing and playing along to recordings, which I know folks did, you know, with blues and jazz and still do. And then that also made me think about distribution of records by people like C.L. Franklin or even Martin Luther King, and the way records and a sort of practice, a cultural practice of a direct engagement with records is like a way of sort of distributing culture or participating in culture. And I wonder about the piece having possibly some gesture towards that kind of thing too, as a sort of material analysis.
I think that's a really interesting line of thinking. primarily because William Brown was a supreme interpreter of the spiritual. And one wonders if there are how much tape and how many splices are left. So one would think, and where those splices are and how much of that tradition or his approach to singing and singing spirituals in that way could be passed down, so to speak, as an emblem or of cultural memory or something like that, you know? I haven't really thought about that, because whoever performs this piece as Olly Wilson envisioned it will always have to sing with William Brown.
Yeah, yeah.
And so for that reason, that's a really interesting way to think about the continuance and expansion of this particular tradition. And I should also say there are some moments in the score where Brown's recorded voice is notated. So perhaps there might be a way to kind of figure out some of the rhythmic and some of the gestural things that Brown does in any given moment that Wilson chose to include in that tape recording. I guess pressing forward to a more oral, if you will, history by listening to records and using that, you know, that's how a lot before Jamie Ebersole, that's how folks learned how to improvise jazz, was listening to other people and emulating style and transcribing their own solos. So before jazz pedagogy became a thing, and you have your play along records when you kind of improvise along with the rhythm section that's blaring in your speakers, you learn how to improvise by emulating. You know, I learned how to play the piano by listening to the radio and recording the pop songs that I liked and then playing along with them as long as my batteries held up in my boombox. So that's how I learned to play, and then you translate and transfer those things from genre to genre, you know, and so then you start to understand that really genre is more context than anything else, because, you know, C7 is C7. What I do with it in jazz might be something totally than what I do with it if I'm playing rock organ, you know, and so, you know, but learning those structures through that tradition is really interesting. That's a really interesting point from the standpoint of the surviving tapes of Wilson being a holder, if you will, you know, or keeper of tradition.
Never. And maybe something happens too if the original, presumably there's like a digitization of the tape, and then there's like the original analog tape, and that will change over time. And you get, you know, different materiality, the way records degrade, and then maybe you pick something up that you heard or you miss something that's not there anymore, that kind of thing.
Right. Yeah. And so that's one of the challenges with those tape pieces. I'm thinking about the In Memoriam for MLK piece by Olly Wilson, where we have a surviving recording of the piece that was premiered at Oberlin, but no one can find the actual tape that the choir performed with. So essentially that piece is lost until we find the tape. We have the score, we have the choir part, but we don't have the accompaniment. So that part, you know, and it's not at Oberlin. They've been looking for it. I think they've even asked me, you know, like, do you know where it might be? I was like, I have no clue, you know. So that's the other part. I really would like to hear that piece staged live, you know.
Yeah,
the In Memoriam MLK for choir and tape. You know, what was really going on compositionally with black composers from 1968 to 1972 is really, really interesting. As you come out of the civil rights movement and go into black power.
Yeah. Cool, thank you.
Well, perhaps we should let, it must be, well, I guess it's not too late, but it's still getting late in Waco a little bit. And so it's been a fascinating evening. Once again, so many things to think about, so much music to go out and seek and listen to. Thank you so much, Horace. And yes, thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you all for coming.
Yes, indeed. Thank you all. It was fun.